Still waking up a little bit? I feel you. Well, you look great. Well, 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul tells us that we should be thankful in every circumstance. And so this morning, I just want to ask you, what are you thankful for? Candy? Yeah, candy. Chocolate? Yes. Family? Thank you for family. Home? Milk? It's a good one. Your mommy and daddy? That's good. What else? White milk? I like white milk, I like chocolate milk. Those are all good answers. You're talking about family and having a home. What are things that only God can give to you that you are thankful for? Love. Life. Yeah, it's pretty significant if he takes those things away from you, right? Yeah. No? Well? Well, we can talk about that. But why are we thankful? Because he died on the cross for us. And this benefits us quite a bit, right? We're thankful because when somebody gives you something, when somebody gives you candy, you're thankful because you have candy now, right? So Jesus dies on the cross for us. We are thankful because he has given us something. And our gratitude, that's what we give him in return. And so I just wanted to highlight that, think about why you're thankful. Think about what God gives you. Especially as we're heading into Thanksgiving, this family season, there's a lot of stuff going on. And we have lots of reasons to be thankful. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are thankful for you. We are thankful for your word and your guidance. We are thankful for our families. And we are thankful that you have given us things like chocolate. You've made life sweet. And we just want to glorify you for everything you have done for us. Let us never forget that. Thank you. In your name, amen.
So it's 6:37. We gather together. Hello.
pray for the offering. Lord, we thank you for the ability to give, and that this giving shows us our gratitude for how you will use this money to go spread your word and affect the lives of the people in this community and beyond. Thank you for how you use the resources that you have given us. In your name we pray, amen. for all the hard work you put in. Thank you. Well, you can go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Psalm 30, all 12 verses of it. There's not 23 verses. If some of you are a little bit concerned about that, it's 12 verses. So Thanksgiving's this week, and I didn't really want to miss out on it. Everything's looking great. We have this beautiful cornucopia up here. It seems like Halloween just happened, right? Like, it's getting faster. Like, Sharon and I still have Halloween candy, but we're having trouble getting through it all. We bought too much. We're going to give some of that away. But, no, Halloween is over. Thanksgiving is here. And I thought it would be appropriate if we were to go through a Thanksgiving psalm. This is a psalm of praise, a psalm of thanksgiving. And I really, when I picked it, I had no idea how appropriate it would actually end up being. Because sometimes when you get to Thanksgiving, you think, oh, it's this holiday called Thanksgiving, but I don't really feel like giving thanks today. Sometimes we don't feel like we are in the mood or in the right place in life to really be giving thanks to God, because sometimes it feels like all we've been given is pain. And I think it is very relevant today. And what I want to do is, today I want to kind of set aside all the thoughts, the busyness, and all the planning that comes with the holiday, all the apprehension, getting all family together, and all of that. I really just want to allow ourselves to be a little more relaxed, a little more vulnerable. The Psalms are Israel's songbook. They are the tunes of the day that they would sing. They are meant for the choir, and as so, their poetry, their art, they are meant to be more emotional. And so, this is not just head knowledge of history. God desires to let us know that He is with us through every situation of life and how we feel. And so, my hope is that by looking at this psalm today, we can see the importance of giving thanks, and that we would be able to come to a place of giving thanks to God. So, I said Psalms is the songbook or the hymn book of the Israelite people. It's poetry. It's poetry and art. It's not the way we think of poetry, though. Because of the nature of the Hebrew language, rhyming is not really a thing that can really just naturally rhymes in and of itself, so it's not feasible. So they actually do rhyming or parallel thought, ideas, parallel and contrasting ideas. So all the poetry is meant in the content. So that's important, because if it feels repetitive, that means the author is trying to underline something, really draw it out. But there's a bunch of little gems in there that we can usually just read right by. So Psalm 30, what we're going to go through, it's ascribed to David. The superscription says it's to David. This means it could have been written by David, but it also could have been written by somebody in David's house. It could have been written to David. We don't really know. It has some connection in some way to David. It's in the very first book of the Psalms. There's five books. And so it's very possible that David wrote it. It's also, it says it's the dedication of the house. And this is also problematic because, well, what house? Well, house could mean his palace. It could mean some other house. It could even mean the temple. But David didn't build the temple. Solomon did. So maybe he wrote this for the day of dedication of the temple? We don't know. This is a psalm that we do know has been used in Hanukkah traditions in the middle of the temple. But that is much later in Jewish history, so trying to place this psalm to a specific story is going to be very difficult. If somebody says that this psalm was at this point in David's life, we don't know that. And so I am upfront with that because a lot of what you are going to get out of this is not going to be some guess of trying to make it fit someplace that's not certain. I want this to get, it's the way the Spirit is going to speak to you. What you're going to get from this is what the Spirit is going to lay on your heart and move with you in your own circumstances. Because just like songs, there's some songs out there that are like, that's a classic. That'll last throughout all of the ages. Like, we're still singing hymns from the 1600s, but there's songs out there that will just, you'll listen to it and you never get sick of it. And this is that way. These songs, they can still speak to us. They can still move us. They can still rock us. And so I want to go ahead and read all 12 verses, and then we're going to go through, and we're just going to slowly go through it and pick it apart. Psalm 30, verse 1. I will exalt you, Lord, because you have lifted me up. You have not allowed my enemies to triumph over me. Lord, my God, I cried to you for help, and you healed me. Lord, you brought me up from Sheol. You spared me from among those going down to the pit. Sing to the Lord, you, his faithful ones, and praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor a lifetime. Weeping may spend the night, but joy is in the morning. When I was secure, I said, I will never be shaken. Lord, when you showed your favor, you made me stand like a strong mountain. When you hid your face, I was terrified. Lord, I called to you. I sought favor from my Lord. What gain is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your truth? Lord, listen and be gracious to me. Lord, be my helper. You turned my lament into dancing. You removed my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness so that I can sing to you and not be silent. Lord, my God, I will praise you forever. So, the author, the psalmist, opens up with this declaration of praise. So there's structure to this psalm. He opens up with praise and says, I will praise you, Lord. Well, why? Well, we don't know exactly what happened, but we know that something terrible has happened to this person. Some kind of affliction, disease, maybe family trouble, might be political trouble. Something has put his life in danger. And he starts with praising God that his enemies aren't praising his downfall. That there are people out there that are trying to torpedo him, and they would gladly rejoice at seeing him fail. And he goes, instead, I'm going to praise God because they're not praising my failure. And so that's all of a sudden a poetic contrast right out the gate. Look at this. The author prayed and God answered with healing. I cried for you and you healed me. Look at the imagery here that says, you have lifted me up. And that's contrasted with those of going down to Sheol, down to the grave. Now, the grave, Sheol, right now, it's not necessarily used in terms of an afterlife. It's used in the way of just death. We're just talking about being laid in the ground. But to draw up, this is drawing up from a well. This is like drawing up well water. You're lifting me up from a place that I was cast down. Like I fell into a well and you pulled me out of it. The pit, this is literally a cistern. So desert land, it only rains, what, 3-4 months out of the year? And so they have to save all of that water. So what they'll do is they will dig a very big pit, and with a very tiny opening at the top, and they will use that to store their water for the entire year. And so what would happen is, if you had an empty cistern and you had somebody that was causing some trouble, like a criminal, well, if you don't have time to get them to jail, let's just go throw them in there. They ain't going anywhere. They can't get out of it. It's about 20 feet deep. They can't climb that. A little opening about that big at the top. In fact, this is the kind of thing that Joseph was thrown into by his brothers when they sold him into slavery back in Genesis. They threw him into a cistern because he couldn't get out of it. They did the same thing with Jeremiah. And this author is using this as a metaphor for the grave. I was down in a pit I could not get out of, and you lifted me out. I cried for help, and you healed me. And so this individual prays. He then moves in verse 4 from just a singular praise to God to calling for the rest of his community to join him. Join me in praise. He says, sing to the Lord, you, his faithful ones, and praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor a lifetime. Weeping may spend the night, but there is joy in the morning. This is a very, very famous phrase. Weeping comes in the evening, but joy comes in the morning. Now this whole section here is called for communal praise. This is the choir kicking in after a solo. He's saying, I was singing praise to God, but now I want everybody to rejoice because you have seen what happened to me. I want you all to know and see what happened to me. And let me tell you, in a small town, everybody knows what happened to you. Right? So you might as well own up to it. He says, your holy name. Praise his holy name. This is more of a memorial. Praise his name memorial, the memory of his name. And this is actually a direct reference to Exodus 3:15, where God is revealing him to Moses, and Moses says, who should I say send me? And he says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so this wordage here is meant to take us all the way back and remember the things that God has done for Israel, to remember his faithfulness. He has brought us out of slavery, brought us through a sea. He has brought us through all of this amazing hardship. And that is the kind of God that we have here. He is a God who has a reputation of saving and deliverance. But not only that, his anger, God's favor, his grace is stronger than his anger. Look at this. His anger lasts for a moment and it's gone. His favor, his grace, it lasts for a lifetime. Now, there's also a little bit of a translation thing here that allows it to say his favor is life. And I would be inclined to say that they're both very accurate. When you're in God's good graces, not only does he bless you, not only does it last for a lifetime, but it gives you life. If you think God is angry at you, this tells me that this should only last for a moment. If you think God's angry with you, then think about it. Maybe you are repeatedly making him angry. His grace lasts for a lifetime. His favor. He wants to love you more than he wants to be angry with you. Seek his favor instead. And this famous, weeping may last for the night, but joy comes in the morning. The word is, the way that is used here is, sorrow is coming for a sleepover. It's going to come into your house. It's going to lay down in your bed, and it's going to spend the night. It's going to get cozy with you. But guess what? joy. It's coming in the morning. And it is not just going to spend the night, it is going to stay with you permanently. We go through times of sorrow and pain, and it's difficult to see how it's ever going to end. But the psalmist is trying to tell us that this is temporary. There are reasons that joy is going to come. Wait for it. Wait for the dawn. Wait for when it comes for you. Wait for the sunrise. The Jewish day starts at sundown. It's a little bit different than us. It starts at sundown. And their day ends at the next sundown. I would encourage you to wait for the sunrise. If you're going through darkness, wait for the light. So we need to remember not only to thank God for the things that he has done for us, but to rejoice with the church as well. He's calling for the church, for his community, to join him in this praise of God because of what God has done. Come be restored to this community. Come share what has happened with each other. Sometimes we only share our hurt and our pain, and we never share the things that make us happy, the things that we're glad that God has done for us, that we can praise him for. You're not alone. You know that? And not just in the bad times. You're not alone in the good times, too. Rejoice. Maybe you've had trouble getting a job and finally got one. Celebrate with the community. Maybe the doctors found cancer. And now you're cancer-free. Come, be a part of this community. Restore. Maybe you've been stuck in what seems to be a pit of despair, and you're scared because things seem to be going all right now, but I'm scared that life's just going to knock me down again. Don't let that keep you away. Come celebrate. Give thanks to God, not just by yourself. Come be a part of this community. Tell the church, let's praise them together. Now, the psalmist is about to describe a bit of what caused him to pray this prayer of crisis to God. Let's read verse 6. When I was secure, I said, I will never be shaken. Lord, when you showed your favor, you made me stand like a strong mountain. When you hid your face, I was terrified. I called to you, I sought favor from my Lord. What gain is there in my death? If I go down to the pit, will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your truth? Lord, listen and be gracious to me and be my helper. This is about your attitude. This author seems to indicate that his pride, his complacency in life, led him to think that he is the one who had raised himself and made himself strong. Strong as a mountain. Nothing stronger than a mountain. I've fallen down one. It's not nothing stronger than a mountain. It hurts. But I didn't put that there. God put that there. And this arrogance of thinking that I am a self-made person. I am doing just fine. I don't need anybody else. I don't need God's help. He's saying this is what led to his downfall. It kept him from thinking that anything could happen to me. Nothing will happen to me. I will never fall. I will never be shaken. But then what happens? It says that God was silent. And this is a way of saying that at least the author indicated he was so sure of himself that when he looked for God, he couldn't find him. And then all of a sudden he came to the realization, nothing I have will last. God is the one who sustained and made me a strong person. God is the one who lifted me up and is the one who holds me together. And I took it for granted and I didn't realize that until I couldn't find him. Sometimes we don't realize what God's actually doing for us until he stops. ever say, Lord, I called to you. It's interesting how God is silent and you get this imagery of the psalmist going, where are you? I called for you. Where are you? I need you. I sought favor from my Lord. How did he declare this? He says, what benefit is there if you just let me die? He's telling God, why? If you just let everything end right here, I see no benefit to this. Because what's going to happen? There's going to be one less person on this earth that praises you. And that's not a good thing. Not that I'm trying to preserve myself, but this doesn't benefit you, God, if you just let this all come down on me. This allusion to dust. Will the dust praise you? This is going all the way back to Genesis 2:7, the creation of man. Man is made from dust. And so he's using this imagery of saying, Lord, you created me from this dust, but if you let me return to dust, is that going to praise you? No, the thing you have formed from it praises you. This is great poetry here. A painter isn't reflected by a bunch of paint supplies sitting in a store. An architect isn't reflected by a pile of building supplies just sitting there. You build, you create. It is that that reflects the Creator. Praising God shows our faithfulness to Him. It is worthwhile to praise Him and thank Him for the things that He has done. He knows that we are thankful, yes. We know that our parents love us, but yet, don't you love seeing that twinkle in their eye, that smile on their face when they hear you say it? Praise shows God our faithfulness, our thankfulness. So I say, do we really acknowledge the things that God is holding up in our lives? Do we know what it would look like if He were to remove them? Are we taking things for granted? I want us to thank Him for them. I'm thankful for this church. I'm thankful for my friends, my family. I'm thankful for air conditioning, heat. It's nice. I'm thankful because I want us to praise God because we reflect God. So after making this case for praise, the author turns once again to the main focus of this psalm, which is praise. It's not just a psalm of praise, it's a psalm about praise. He says, I want to go back to it. Verse 11, you turned my lament, my sorrow, into dancing. You removed my sackcloth and clothed me with gladness, so that I can sing to you and not be silent. Lord my God, I will praise you forever. This is a celebration of this reversal of circumstances that God has brought about. You've turned my mourning into dancing. Mourning, this is specifically a dirge, a song, a lament given traditionally at a funeral. And the author here is saying, that was my funeral. You turned what would be my funeral into a cause for dancing and celebration. You have given me renewed life. I thought I was done for. You've turned my sackcloth, which is something unique to this day and age, is one of the ways that they would mourn is they would publicly mourn by putting on sackcloth. And you might hear the phrase sackcloth and ashes. I'm going to go, you know, put my ashes all over myself and sit in ashes in the sackcloth so that everyone will know that I have been hit in life with the deepest sorrow that I can have. And the imagery here, you have taken, we wear, probably the best illustration is that we have Occasionally, it's not really done much anymore, but when we go to funerals, people will wear black. That's the same thing that's going on here. He's saying, you have taken this off of me. You've taken this sackcloth. You've taken these black clothes off of me, this mourning attire, this sorrow attire, and you have clothed me with joy, with gladness. You ever see some people where, like, they're just full of joy, and then you just, like, you see them and your day is better? You don't even have to talk to them. Your day just gets better because you've seen this person, because they exude joy. Joy just comes out of them. It's like they are wearing joy. It is what they have put on that day and every day. And he's saying, this is what's happening. The Lord has taken these old, filthy, dirty mourning clothes, and he has put this joy on me to where everyone sees it and goes, look at what God has done in the life of that person. Do people see your joy? Can they tell your hope comes from a different place? Or are we still wearing these old rags? Now, there's a proper time for mourning. There's a proper time for sorrow. It lasts for the night. But don't push joy away when it comes, when God tries to put it on you. The next thing he does, he ends this psalm with praise. So that I can praise you. You've given me joy for the reason that I can come and I can praise you. You didn't just do it for the sake of doing it. You wanted me to be able to approach you. This God that was silent said, I'm going to give you joy so that you can come and you can share that joy with me. And then the psalmist gives this thing. He says, I will sing you, I will not be silent. Isn't it amazing that when God was silent, that was what caused this author to go after him even more? And he says, because you were silent, I will not. I will not be silent. I will praise you. Because he knows that the prayer, the reaching out, is what saved him. If you're silent when you're in trouble, nobody's going to know how to get you out of it. Reach out, especially to God. And so now he is dancing, rejoicing, and singing to God. And he ends with this declaration, I will sing praise to you forever. This circumstance does not keep me from knowing that God is good all the time. Prayer isn't just asking for stuff. It's thanking God for the things that he has done. He lifts us up, restores us. He sustains us, and he loves us. This Thanksgiving, I want you to think about all the things that you have that God has put in place that he had sustained. What would it look like if you lost these things he has blessed you with? And then thank him for it. Let's thank him now. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this psalm, for your word, that you are so in love with us, that you run after us in our time of sorrow and pain and mourning, and that you seek to restore us and give us joy. I thank you that you feel our emotions, and you don't leave us where we are. You lift us up out of the darkness. Thank you for all that you do. Amen. pray. Dear Lord, you are so good. I ask that you would be with us as we go from here, that you would be with us over this holiday, and that you would give us a reason to be thankful for something, for your providence, for your protection, for the good things that you put in our lives or have put in our lives. And I pray that you would allow us to have a great time with friends, family, but that we would not forget you. In your name we pray, amen.